Buddy, how are you doing today? Happy November. Today is November 1st. And you guys, I saw lots of you yesterday at the Halloween webinar. So we had Halloween last night, and we also set our clocks back in America at 2 a.m. So you set it back before you go to bed, and we have a time change. So it's 7 in the morning here instead of 8 when I usually talk to you guys. So it's so good to see you guys. I see everybody here. Let me know where you're from so I can remember. I see Jason and Yolanda, lots of people that I normally see Henry and Brandon, of course, and Annie and Yolanda and Ellie. Let's see, I think I saw Lisa. Yeah, this is great. I'm so glad you guys are back. This is wonderful. Hi, Annie. Right, you're from Shizu, and then Henry. And well, let me know where you're from, guys, so I can remember. Hi, Jason. Great. Lots of people. Ellie's from Shanghai, and Austin's probably with her, and Annie. Wonderful. Wonderful. Okay, well, we're going to talk about jellyfish today. So, jellyfish are not really fish. They constantly eat, okay, and they can sting you. Yeah, so let's talk about different types. They're not really electric fish, Jason. They're kind of just plankton, which is a type of animal in the ocean that just kind of moves along with the currents. It doesn't really swim. So plankton or anything from microscopic to where you can't see it, you need a microscope to big jellyfish. They're all in the same kind of class. And we'll talk about who eats them, mainly sea turtles, but lots of things eat them. So let me share my screen and let me pull up. I got a couple cool things for you guys to see. Let me get this. And they don't have a heart. They don't have bones. Okay. They don't really have a brain. Okay. Ocean's alive jellyfish. No heart, no bones, nothing. Okay. No brain. So, jellyfish, guys, by the way, are found in every part of the ocean. Okay. They're found around the whole world. So that's kind of cool. You guys hopefully know your continents. You guys are over here in Asia, okay? Most of you. I'm in North America over here in the green. I know we have one person I think is in Canada. All we have different time zones here. So like I said, we set our clocks back in America. So we have all kinds of jellyfish all over the whole world. South America, Africa, Australia, Antarctica. The box jellyfish is the scariest jellyfish. In the whole world, the deadliest jellyfish. The sting can hurt you very badly. A lot of those are found more in the Pacific Ocean around Australia. Okay. So you guys probably already know your oceans, I hope. You guys are over here by Asia or in Asia. You're by the Pacific Ocean. The Earth is round, so the Pacific Ocean wraps right around to this side of North America. And then we have the Atlantic, which is where I live by. Okay, then we have the Indian Ocean right here between Africa and Australia in the bottom of Asia. And the Southern Ocean is down here and the Arctic Ocean. So scientists really say there are five main oceans. Here's our compass. People call this a compass rose or cardinal direction. So the north is the top of the map and the south, see the S there? The south is, that's why that's called the Southern Ocean. Over here is the west, over here is the east. And we know that we wrap around into a whole earth. And if you're in my classes, you probably already remember that. All right, let me go back to our book. Ocean Life Up Close, Jellyfish. And yeah, I've been stung by a jellyfish or two or three or four or a lot. Okay, so it does hurt. It stings, they say stings. You get out of the water, and normally it kind of goes away after a while. We'll talk about stings in a minute. So, what exactly are jellyfish? They don't have any bones. We just said that. If you don't have a backbone and you don't have bones, you're an invertebrate. You have no spine. Okay. Jellyfish are a type of plankton. Remember, I said that word a minute ago? They are not actually fish. Some people believe that jellies is a better name for them. So, they're really not fish. They have long tentacles here. This is called the Pacific sea nettle. These invertebrates have lived on Earth for millions of years. By the way, they live for 600 million years. They've been here a long time. Jellyfish existed before dinosaurs. Jellyfish are found all over the world's oceans. They drift through ocean water, open water. Many live in shallow coastal waters, but some are in the deepest parts of the ocean. Shallow means it's really, really not above your head if you're an adult, okay? Shallow means it's not deep. So here's a certain type of jellyfish called a sea wasp. Ooh, they live less than a year. Their depth range is about 0 to 131 feet or 40 meters. So they go kind of deeper. And the range here they have on our book, they have an orange color. They show you where in the world they're found. Okay, so they're found right over here, more in Australia. And it says orange down here on our key says they're vulnerable, meaning they could be endangered, but they're not. They're not threatened, okay? Least concern, meaning they're not really going to go out anytime soon. There's a lot of them, okay? So down here is a key showing us if extinct, which dinosaurs would be in the red, and jellyfish are in the green. Least concern, okay? Not really concerned that they're going to be gone. Truly jelly? Water makes up most of a jellyfish's soft, bell-shaped body. Jellyfish bodies are usually clear. They easily blend in with the water, and some are brightly colored. So you have some of the smallest here. Look, that's how little they are. You can't really see them. There's some smaller than that. They're called plankton. These are all called plankton. The largest is the lion's mane jellyfish. A lion has a back mane, like the stuff of the fur around their head. That's a mane. So look how big this thing is compared to a human. They put it up here so you can really get the scale. It's 8 feet long. A typical human, maybe a tall man, would be 6 foot, 5 foot. So this thing is 2.4 meters long. Whoa. I don't want to be around him, okay? And they have these things called tentacles that come out. Those are the stingers. So far, pretty crazy. Oh, a lot of water sound is coming from the computer, probably from one of my videos. Let me go back and make sure they're not on. Yep. Oh, you know why? Let me show you what's on. That's why there's a water sound. Watch this, guys. I go with my classes a lot. I have cameras around the world. Here's a camera. I'll turn off the sound here. This is in California. This is live. Okay, this is in a tank. Okay, so they're just kind of floating around there. And let me turn off the sound there. They're floating around. This is in an aquarium in California. Right now in California, it's about 4 a.m. in the morning. So there you can see this. And this is kind of, it's kind of mesmerizing. You can just watch, and mesmerizing means you kind of go, wow, and you just relax a little bit. People have jellyfish on their screensavers for their computer, or maybe on their TV for a little screensaver, just because they're very relaxing. I don't want to be in that tank with them, but they're very relaxing. So this is in California. You can see them kind of with their long tentacles. I'm not sure what type this is. It's an aquarium. I guess it's in Long Beach, California, in the USA. Like right now, guys, my home, I am on the East Coast. The sun's just come up. This is what it looks like at my home right now, okay? It's going to be a pretty day for a while, and then I think we're going to have a cold front come through and some rain. So I live by the ocean. So this is my home, and the sun's just coming up there. All right. Let me go back to another video I can show you about jellies, just so you learn a little bit about them. Oh, here's another screensaver too, guys. I was looking at this. This is mesmerizing as well. Let me show this to you. Watch this. You can barely hear the light music playing. They are beautiful. And they call, I'll turn off the sound, they call this the head or the bell. It's like a bell you could ring. And these are the tentacles, okay? So no bones, no spine, no nothing, all right? Just jelly, gelatinous. Jelly, if you think about putting jelly on a sandwich or a biscuit, it's very soft. Think of gelatin you might have as a dessert that kind of wiggles and wobbles to keep it cold. Those are all things like a jellyfish. Okay, they can change color. Yolanda, it just depends on the type. There's many different species or types. Yes, thousands of stinging cells, that's for sure. Let me show you something about that. All right, let me go out of that. Here's a little information about jellies. You can see this little guy, he is snorkeling. Snorkeling means you have this above the water so you can breathe. I've done that many times. Scuba diving is different when you have oxygen or air on your back and a long tank and you can go very deep. Some people can go deep when they snorkel. They just come up for air. When I use this, you can, if you get any water in your mouth, you can push it and blow it right outside the air hole. It comes right out. And you might come to the surface and breathe for a second. And then sometimes you have your goggles and they get fogged up. You can kind of put water in them and swish it around and empty it and then put it back on your face. It suction cups to your face. I've snorkeled with sea turtles, all kinds of stuff. I was snorkeling one day out in the ocean in off Florida, and Florida is known for their sharks. It wasn't very deep, but I was snorkeling around coral reefs, which are colorful little rocks in the ocean. And I came up, and the other boaters, the people on the boat says, you know, there's been some sharks around here. So I got out of the water. Anyway, this guy's snorkeling and he's looking at jellyfish. Let's hear what they say and tell us a little bit about jellyfish.
You're swimming in the ocean when something brushes your leg. When the tingling sets in, you realize you've been stung by a jellyfish. How do these beautiful gelatinous creatures pack such a painful punch? Jellyfish are soft because they are 95% water and are mostly made of a translucent gel-like substance called mesoglia. With such delicate bodies, they rely on thousands of venom-containing stinging cells called cnidocytes.
Now remember, these cnidocytes, these tentacles, they say stinging. A lot of times, guys, they're stinging fish that they want to eat or little things that pass by that they want to eat. They're not stinging humans, okay? And a lot of times, these stinging cells will kill a fish, I'll show you in a second, but they might only give you a little hurt. What I did when I was stung, I was water skiing behind a boat, and I got in the boat, and I had, you know, I didn't even really know I was getting stung. You don't really know when you're in the water sometimes until you get out and you're like, ooh. And I had little red little spots. It wasn't really bad, but I had a lot of stings. If you can get some meat tenderizer, which you put on meat to make it tender before you cook it, and you put that on and your sting goes right away. But these stinging cells would kill a fish or something small in the ocean, but they might just give you a little bit of a red rash and then it gets better. Now, there are some jellyfish that can kill bigger things, so I'll show you that in just a second. But these cnidocytes, notice the C is silent. You don't go cnidocytes, it's cnidocytes. They're their tentacles, and they have the stinging cells in them.
For protection and prey capture, even baby jellyfish, the size of a pencil eraser, have the ability to sting. Larval jellyfish, ephyrae, look like tiny flowers pulsating in the sea. As they grow, they become umbrella-shaped with a bell at the top and descending tentacles around the margin. The largest species of jellyfish,
whoa,
the lion's mane, has tentacles that can extend more than 100 feet, longer than a blue whale. These tentacles contain most of the stinging cells.
So you see, that was the one our book just talked about. I mean, look at that compared to a person, compared to the blue whale, which is one of the biggest fish in the ocean.
These tentacles contain most of the stinging cells, although some species have them on their bells too. Venom is ejected via a nematocyst, a whip-like hollow tubule, which lies coiled under high osmotic pressure. When mechanical or chemical stimuli activate an external trigger, the lid of the cell pops open and seawater rushes in. This forces a microscopic barbed harpoon to shoot out, penetrate and inject venom into its victim. Nematocyst discharge can occur in less than a millionth of a second, making it one of nature's fastest biomechanical processes. Nematocysts can continue to fire even after a jellyfish has died, so it's important to remove lingering tentacles stuck to the skin. Rinsing with vinegar will usually render undischarged nematocysts inactive. Seawater can also help remove residual nematocysts. But don't use fresh water, because any change in salt balance alters the osmotic pressure outside of the cnidocyte and will trigger the nematocyst to fire.
So it says don't put regular water on it. So you got a bottle of water at the beach and your mom's like, let me help you. Get it back in seawater, because the fresh water triggers more of that venom to really come out and really hurt you.
That's why urinating on the affected area, a common folk remedy, may do more harm than good depending on the composition of the urine. Most jellyfish stings are a painful nuisance, but some can be deadly. an Indo-Pacific box jelly, also called a sea wasp, releases venom which can cause contraction of the heart muscles and rapid death in large doses. There's an anti-venom, but the venom is fast-acting, so you need immediate medical intervention. Despite the impressive power in their tentacles, jellies aren't invincible. Their stinging cells are no match for the armor of thick-skinned predators like the leatherback turtle and ocean sunfish. These predators both have adaptations that prevent slippery jellyfish from escaping after they are engulfed.
That's what I was telling you guys earlier, that yes, they do have things that eat them. Now, one problem, if you went to my webinar on sea turtles, which are one of my favorite animals, they eat jellyfish. A lot of times if they're looking in the ocean, they're looking up at the top of the ocean and they see what they think is a jellyfish, but it's a plastic bag and they eat that thinking it's a jellyfish and then they die. Okay, so it's very sad that we have so many plastics in the ocean, even plastics that we really can't see. There are so many microscopic plastics in the ocean from people. So sad for the jellyfish, sad for the sea turtle, but they do eat jellyfish. That's one of their main predators, meaning things that eat them.
Backwards pointing spines in the turtle's mouth and esophagus, and recurved teeth behind the sunfish's cheeks. Even tiny slipper lobster larvae can cling to the bell of a jellyfish and hitch a ride, snacking on the jelly while they preserve their own energy for growth. Small agile fish use the jellies as moving reefs for protection, darting between tentacles without ever touching them.
Wow.
Nudibranchs, which are sea slugs covered in protective slime, can actually steal the jelly's defenses by eating the cnidocytes and transferring them to specialized sacs for later.
So we like sea slugs. I never knew. Sea slugs are sitting there minding their own business, and the jellyfish comes along and has these tentacles hanging down, and this guy can actually snag them. It doesn't hurt him.
For use as weapons against their own predators.
Huh.
Even humans might benefit from the sting of a jellyfish one day. Scientists are working on manipulating cnidocytes to deliver medicine with nematocysts rarely 3% of the size of a typical syringe needle. So the next time you're out in the ocean, be careful, but also take a second to marvel at its wonders.
Absolutely. So if you've ever gone to the ocean, you may have seen a jellyfish. Sometimes they walk on, you're walking on the beach and they've washed up and they can't get back out, obviously. And so they die, they dry out in the sun. Okay, yeah. So yeah, Jason, jellyfish are, you know, they look like a plastic bag in the ocean to many of these poor little sea turtles and to some fish, and then they die eating this, what they think is of a jellyfish, and it's a plastic bag. All right, let's go back to our jellies. And like I told you, they live everywhere. Even in the northern, they don't have to have hot water. They can have cold water. They live all over the world in all of the oceans. Some are in shallow water, like our book said, not very deep, and some are very deep where there no light reaches down. So jellyfish are at all water levels, and they're at in every ocean. When I talk about water levels, this is what I mean. You might have jellyfish up here. That'd be very shallow. You're sitting on the beach, drinking your water, and you walk out, tip your toes in there. Oh, cool. Jellyfish could be up here, and they can also be down very deep. There's different levels of the ocean. And I told you that many plankton, not just their jellyfish, are part of the family called plankton. There's three groups in the ocean. There's the swimmers, there's the floaters, and there's the ones that crawl on the bottom. Okay. So these are called plankton. They float. The other group is called swimmers, and they're called nekton. And the way I remember it is they swim with their neck. They're called nekton. And the other ones are called benthic, meaning bottom. They live and walk on the bottom. So jellyfish are part of the group, like I said, plankton, that float. Plankton can be very small, you need a microscope, or very big, like the one that we just saw, that wasp jellyfish. So here's some that live off the Great Barrier Reef in Australia. They're mostly made of water, like we said. Some have no color, but some have lots of color. Okay, so here's some different types. Lots of different types, different colors as well. Let me go back to our book, and then we'll go back to some more interesting stuff about jellyfish. I wonder what those jellyfish are doing right now in the tank. I bet they're probably just hanging out like they were before. Let's check in real quick, and then I'll go to something else. And I go to lots of aquariums and things like that when I'm in my classes. So you can see Let's see. Here's another aquarium. This is also in California. And this is some very colorful fish. They're tropical. They like warm waters. I don't think there's any jellies in this one. Okay, they probably eat a lot of those fish. So you guys can see the aquarium there. Just some colorful. These are called spade fish. Okay, they have the kind of the hook on their back. Whoa, see that guy? It's like Finding Nemo. Did you guys see that? All of a sudden a dory appeared. Look at that pretty yellow one. Maybe that's Nemo, speaking of that. All right, let's go back to check in on our book, and then we'll go back to something else. Thank you guys for being with me today. This is great. I love, my best part of my week is webinar. I got two this weekend. I'm so lucky. And I have one next weekend too. Make sure you go. I'll tell you about it at the end. Truly jelly. Water makes up most of a jellyfish's soft bell-shaped body. And this is the one we just saw, the lion's mane. They talked about in our in the video. Okay, and we already saw this with the colors there. Whoops. Tentacles. That's what I want to know about. Tentacles hang down from the jellyfish's body. Some jellies also have arms like ribbons. So they have arms and tentacles. Remember, this is their bell-shaped head. They just said it like when you hit gong, you hit a bell. Identifying a sea nettle. Jellyfish do not have bones, blood, or a brain, like we said at the beginning, but some can sense light or smell. Didn't know that. Their tentacles can feel animals that touch them. Okay, so here's a little part of their body right here. Okay, like I said, here's the bell, which is the head. Tentacles, which are different than arms. Okay, so you've got these long ribbon-like things called tentacles. Those have the stinging, remember the nematocyst that the video just talked about? And then here's just arms that kind of help them move, like your arms help you move, okay? Drifters, remember I told you this is where they're called plankton. To swim, jellyfish open and close their bell. They push water out from their body to move forward. And we just saw this in the little video I showed you live from California. They're kind of just going like that, going around. Ooh, this is called the spotted jellyfish. It looks almost like a fun balloon you'd have at a party. But I don't want that at my party. Pretty. Jellyfish do not move very fast like this. Most swim little and just float with the currents. Currents are around the whole world. Okay, you have a very big current by you called the Asia Current. I have the biggest current by my home called the Gulf Stream. Okay, by the way, I do teach oceanography for Ivy too. So I like to talk about a lot of stuff in my oceanography class if you're interested in taking that science class. Jellies hunt as they drift. The carnivores, I bet you've heard that word. If you haven't, here you go. Eat other plankton such as tiny crabs and fish. Carnivores eat meat. Herbivores eat only plants, okay? And if you eat them both, like you and me, you might eat your noodles and your salad and your beef. You are an omnivore. You eat it all. Like last night at trick-or-treating, lots of candy did I eat. Today, not a good day. Not good for me to eat all that candy. Their trailing tentacles brush against prey and sting them with their venom. Then the food is brought up to the mouth inside their bell. So do you see how here, guys, he's actually captured a fish? I mean, look at this other fish right there. So he's going to have a good dinner or breakfast, whatever it is. It's called the blue fire jellyfish. That's kind of pretty. If he can get something that big, if he was by a human, it could really hurt. It wouldn't kill you. But like the video said, the box jellyfish, which is the worst jellyfish in the whole world, the deadliest, would sting you so much that your skin would hurt, but it goes right to your heart and kind of gives your heart a big jolt that's not very good. So that's how they kill, okay? Whoa, catch of the day. Here's plankton, by the way. Little, this is under a microscope, okay? So they're in the group called plankton as well. They don't swim. They just kind of float around with the currents. Another type of plankton would be a mosquito larvae. You guys ever have mosquitoes that bite you? They're so small you can't see their eggs, and that's what they're showing here, okay? All right, let me go back to, yeah, sad fish, Yolanda, but probably good for the jellyfish to eat, that's for sure. Oh, yes, Lisa, I do lots of webinars. Thank you for that compliment. That was wonderful. All right, let me show you 5 reasons to thank jellyfish, because we've been saying all these bad things about them, but let's show you some good things. And then I'll show you something else bad about them. Okay, this would be what plankton would look like. You can't see them. They're in the water. And just think, guys, something like a blue whale. that doesn't have teeth. They have baleen, which is like a comb. You know how you comb your hair? That would be the teeth. The teeth of a blue whale. They don't eat fish. They are the biggest animals in the ocean, and they eat plankton. Imagine how many plankton they have to eat in one day to stay alive. And there's lots and lots of whales out there. The orca killer whale, it's called killer whale. It's got the black and the white on the front. They have baleen as well. They don't have teeth like us. It's almost like teeth of a comb. If you comb your hair with, like I said. So imagine all, and what happens is as the water comes through these whales' mouths, these little plankton get stuck in their little teeth, the baleen. Like if you get something stuck in your tooth, that's what these have. So there's just tons of plankton in the ocean. We just can't see them. We see the biggest type of plankton, which is a jellyfish. Here's five reasons to thank a jellyfish or thank a plankton.
Plankton recently. You haven't, have you? No one ever does.
Oops, sorry.
They're not adorable. There's.
You see how this is under a microscope, seeing the smallest plankton in the ocean? And then again, we can see the biggest, which is the jellyfish. Watch this.
Bacteria, algae, jellyfish, teensy baby crabs. Basically anything that drifts around with the ocean currents can be called plankton. They're so photogenic that a book's just come out filled with pictures of them. But they don't just float around all day looking pretty. It turns out plankton are keeping us all alive. So start your thank you notes now, because here are five reasons to thank plankton.
Here you go.
Number one, air. Everyone loves trees. Trees fill the air with oxygen and stop global warming and save the planet. So how come no one mentions that photosynthetic plankton, like these diatoms, produce as much oxygen as all the rainforests and land plants put together?
Okay, so again, this is under a microscope. These smaller plankton, we have lots of oxygen because of them.
And absorb carbon dioxide. And slow down climate change. Oh, and they've been doing it for 3 billion years. Take that, trees. Thanks, plankton. Number two, fuel. Here's another thing trees get all the credit for, fuel. You can chop them down as firewood or dig their remains up as coal. But the world's biggest energy source is oil. And can you guess what most of that precious oil is made from? What a surprise, it's plankton. Single-celled creatures like diatoms and dinoflagellates die and sink to the seafloor, where they're crushed and transformed over millions of years into oil and natural gas. Sure, dead trees contribute some of it, but the plankton had a 3 billion year head start.
So, number one, they said they do more than as much as trees. You know, guys, trees take in carbon dioxide and they put out oxygen. It's the opposite of what people do, because when you breathe, it's oxygen, and you breathe out carbon dioxide. Trees do the opposite. So it's like, plant a tree. Trees are great. And trees are wonderful. Guess what? These plankton do the same thing in the oceans. And we never hear about plankton. Again, this is looking under a microscope with a camera. So these are very small. You would not see this if you went to the ocean and were walking in the water. They're saying that these things do the same thing as trees.
Making them the world's largest supplier of fossil fuels. So much for saving the planet. Thanks, plankton. Number three, rocks. When we're not burning plankton's remains for fuel, we're building houses from them. From St. Paul's Cathedral to the Great Pyramids, some of our favourite chunks of rock were once at the bottom of the sea. Hard shells, like on these foraminifera, fall to the ocean floor and end up cemented into sedimentary rocks. Chalk is basically entirely plankton. So what have we learnt? That's right, plankton rocks. Uh-huh. Thanks, plankton. Number four.
Make a lot of rocks.
Fish fingers. Okay, so maybe you can technically survive without fish fingers. Or salmon. Sushi. Mussels. Tuna mayo sandwiches. Okay, let's just say you're vegetarian. The point is, all sea creatures, delicious or otherwise, depend on plankton somewhere in the food chain. Our pals, the photosynthetic plankton, turn sunlight into food for hungry zooplankton, some of which, like krill, feed ever bigger marine predators. So if you liked Finding Nemo, don't thank Disney, don't thank Pixar, thank plankton. Thanks, plankton!
There you go.
Number five, your face. Without plankton, you wouldn't have a face, or legs, or a gallbladder. What I'm getting at here is that we all kind of evolved from plankton. Back when life was just single cells floating in the ocean, planktonic organisms invented photosynthesis. They invented eating each other. They eventually invented the wonder that is multicellular life, which would eventually lead to us. Okay, they didn't technically invent your actual face, but they certainly helped evolution get there. Planks, Thankton.
They mix up the words. So what she's saying is, guys, just in case you didn't know, the Earth is 4.6 billion years old. And for 4 billion of those 4.6 billion years, all there was ocean and single-celled organisms like plankton. So they've been around for a long time. And like she said, eventually we evolved to multi-celled organisms, meaning bigger things like fish, and land plants, and then people. So plankton have been here like forever. And then they evolved into jellyfish, which have been here for 600 million years. Okay. So like I said, with all my types here, and this is just some of the types, okay, in the Pacific, these guys have been here a long time. Yeah. Okay. Here's a couple others, like we said, with the bell-shaped head, the tentacles, and the arms. Okay. The arms are not the parts that are going to sting you. It's the tentacles. Okay. So here's some more body parts. I made this slide up so you could see the many parts of jellyfish. Not that you want to dissect them or take them apart, but just so you know, we've got the bell shape head. We've got the tentacles, the arms, the mouth is on the underside. And then the gut is your stomach, is what some people call their gut. Even people say that about their own stomachs. So these have stinging cells in these arms as well as these tentacles. So yeah, I don't want to be around any of these jellyfish, especially that wasp jellyfish and that lion's mane jellyfish. Yeah, they are amazing. Okay, let me go back and show you something else with our book, and then we'll go move on so I can get through all my stuff. I always plan lots of stuff, and I want to get through it all so that you guys can see it and have time for questions at the end. Okay, this is called the blue fire jellyfish. Like we saw those poor fish. Bye-bye. They're prey, right? And predators are what eat them. Few animals want to eat jellyfish because of their sting. However, jellyfish venom does not harm every predator. Jellies are a treat for some fish. Sea turtles also love snacking on them. And I showed you that. So there's some enemies here that would eat this. So the rockfish can eat the jelly, the leatherback sea turtle, and the ocean sunfish. These sunfishes, they have the ones, if you've ever seen them, they're giant. They can be probably as big as your table in your house, and they have these long arms that kind of come out and flap. I'll say arms, but they're flippers. They're sunfishes. They're some of the biggest things in the ocean. They're bigger than rays, and I did another webinar a few weeks ago on rays, and anyway, so there's the green sea turtle. He's eating him. He's not getting eaten. Okay. Jellyfish would not even be able to eat that because they couldn't digest that shell, right? They have to eat kind of littler things like fish, things that don't really have a lot of bones in them. Coming into bloom, jellyfish begin as eggs. They turn into larvae and drift to the ocean floor. There they attach to a rock or a solid place. So these things are polyps attaching to something. Here's the life cycle of a jellyfish. Okay, cycle, I mean, it goes around, like say a caterpillar might turn into a butterfly. We also have things like the water cycle that never ends. If you're in my science class, we talk about cycles a lot. The rock cycle never ends. So it starts as an egg, like it says, goes to larvae, then a polyp, which is like that. Then it becomes a young jellyfish. Now remember, the one video we saw, some of them stay kind of looking like a little flower in the ocean. They don't look like a big giant Medusa head with long tentacles. This is an adult. It's called a Medusa. Okay, they might stay looking like that, that one species of jellyfish does. Polyps grow from the larvae. A polyp breaks off layers that become young jellyfish. These change into Medusas. Medusa was also in mythology, you know, had all those snakes on her head. I've never seen that, anything like that. Medusas drift often to the ocean. Currents push the jellies into groups called swarms. The jellyfish I have seen look like this. They have the four rings. They're called moon jellyfish. They're the most common, at least in the Atlantic Ocean, and they can range in different sizes. A lot of times I'll see jellyfish at the beach, especially at the beginning of the summer, like in May, and you might have all these jellyfish where you don't even want to hardly get in the water because there's so many of them. Seasonal blooms bring even more jellyfish together. Like I said, different seasons. Blooms mean it blooms like a flower. There's a lot of them. Thousands may collect in bays or coastal waters. Well, this is called the golden jellyfish. Look at all those. Wow. Okay, let me go back out of our book. And they talked about some of the words we did. Yeah, snake gear. Jason, you're right. Let me show you one other little thing about jellyfish. Real quick. And because I think I had one other video that was the same as the one we saw, but let me make sure I've got this. Okay, let me show you one little thing about jellyfish. And this is a longer brain pop, and we're only going to see some of it. And they're called cnidarians, because remember how that word, and I said, oh, it sounds like you would say it with a C sound, because like a K sound, but the C is silent. Okay, called cnidarians. Let's see what they're on. He's got a whole outfit on, like a wetsuit and a bubble, so he doesn't get stung. This looks kind of like the moon jellyfish we talked about. So different types in the ocean. Okay, let me play a little bit of this. It might need me to log in. Does that sometimes? Yep, I'm already logged in. Don't know why. All right. Cnidarians, another name for kind of the family that jellyfish are from, that all plankton are from. Looks pretty harmless, but it's not.
Ah. Dear Tim and Moby, I think jellyfish are cool. What can you teach me about them? From Newt. Jellyfish belong to a phylum of invertebrate aquatic animals called cnidarians. Oh, an invertebrate is an animal with no backbone or spinal column.
Remember how we said jellyfish don't have a backbone, they don't have bones, they don't have a brain, they don't have a heart? But invertebrates means anything that doesn't have a backbone, like we do. We have a backbone or a spine.
Cnidarians are very simple creatures. They typically have only two cell layers. Cnidarians come in two basic shapes, medusa and polyp. But they both have radial symmetry, meaning that if you sliced one down the middle at any point in its body, both sides would be the same. All cnidarians have tentacles radiating out from a central mouth. Medusas are weak swimmers, relying mainly on water currents to move them along. And polyps don't move at all, they're sessile. That means they attach themselves to something else, like a rock or the ocean floor. Well, there are lots of different kinds of cnidarians. They include jellyfish, anemones, coral, hydras, and my personal favorite, the Portuguese man-o-war.
Wow.
Yeah, you don't want to get too close to these animals. Cnidaria is Latin for stinging cells, and there's a good reason for the name. A cnidarian's tentacles are lined with microscopic stinging structures called nematocysts. Each nematocyst contains a coiled-up tube that can shoot out like a harpoon. When a passing animal touches a cnidarian's tentacles, the nematocysts shoot out and attach to the animal. The tentacles draw the prey into the cnidarian's mouth. Some nematocysts contain poison that stun prey. This is the same stuff that causes us to be stung by jellyfish. Anyway, food is broken down inside the cnidarian's body cavity. And since they only have one opening, cnidarians also expel waste from their mouths. Yeah, I don't know if that gives them bad breath. Polyps and medusas also have different ways of reproducing. Medusas reproduce sexually. Females release eggs into the water, and males fertilize the floating eggs. But polyps reproduce asexually in a process called budding. In budding, a polyp will grow a small new outgrowth, or bud, that eventually falls off and becomes a separate organism with the same genetic material as the original. Some cnidarians go through both polyp and medusa stages in their life cycles.
Okay, there was a life cycle that we just saw from our book.
So they reproduce sexually in the medusa stage and asexually in the polyp stage. Yeah, it's pretty cool. By the way, if you see a jellyfish while you're swimming, stay away from it. Okay, stay calm. I think we're safe from this one.
It was a plastic bag, like we just talked about. There are so many in the ocean, even parts of plastics that we can't see. Awful, awful. Okay, let's go back to PowerPoint. because now you see the parts of the jelly, you saw the life cycle of the jelly, and like I said, they go with the currents. So this is what I was talking about earlier. They don't really swim, kind of they propel themselves sometimes, but like our video and our book said, they just kind of drift along with the currents that move back and forth. So by you guys, you have the Kuroshio or the Japanese current. By me, the biggest current in the world is called the Gulf Stream. So you see how some of these are green and some are blue. Red. These red ones are warmer currents and the blue is the colder currents. And these go through the whole ocean because remember, water doesn't just stay there because the earth is turning so slowly, right? Turns once every day. And so you guys are on the nighttime side right now, and I'm on the daytime side. So since the earth is turning and the wind's also blowing, okay, we have currents that are the surface currents at the very top of the ocean, and we have very deep currents too. See this word here, equatorial? That means equator, because remember, this whole long equator divides the top from the bottom. This is the northern part of the earth. We're in the northern hemisphere, you and me. We're in the fall or autumn. The southern hemisphere, Africa, South America, Australia. They're lucky they're in the spring. They're going to have summer soon. Okay, so we have different currents in different parts of the world. And that's what these jellies kind of drift with. Okay, like I said, they've been around for 600 million years. Plankton have been around since the beginning, 4.6 billion years. So, yeah. Lots of time for these guys to live, right? Let me go back to another thing I want to show you. Make sure we have time. Okay. And let me show you this jellyfish. It's a bigger one. Okay. I wanted to show you a little, I don't want to show you the whole thing. This is a long, long show, but I want to show you this little snippet of them talking about jellies in the ocean. Okay.
Creatures on Earth become one of its greatest threats.
Pretty. Okay.
July in the Gulf of Alaska. The jellies are in bloom. Hundreds of thousands of moons are feasting on plankton.
Moon jellyfish.
The lion's mane are here too. A bloom like this can clear the water of other creatures.
Remember, bloom was when we have a lot of them. Like our book said, seasonal. We have a lot of them at a certain time of year. This is a bloom, many.
In hours.
It's not very many predators, believe it or not, in the water that can actually depress the population size of its prey. And jellyfish are able to do that. And so that's going to make them, by default, a dominant predator.
How did a bunch of aimless drifters make it to the top of the food chain? It turns out jellies are neither drifters nor aimless. Scientists Sean Colan and Jack Costello think the way jellies move is key to their success as predators. At Woods Hole in Massachusetts, they're using a high-tech laser system to look at jellyfish propulsion.
Propulsion means the way they move, like a rocket propels or an airplane. It moves, it goes, propel.
The laser creates a special light field. It lets them see both the jelly's motion and the movement of particles in the water.
So it's got it's swimming right through the field. It's got good motion, good particle field.
Back at the Marine Biological Laboratory, they run the images through a program that tracks the particles.
Wow.
See all that water he's moving as he's pulsing the bell.
They immediately notice a little swirl of water that's produced when the jelly relaxes its bell.
Underneath, there's this swirling that we see that is kind of moving at that counterclockwise direction.
That little swirl gives jellies a big boost. A third of their forward motion is achieved without them having to move a muscle.
Wow.
In fact, what we've recently found is that they are probably the most efficient animal that moves. Jellyfish are actually more efficient than fish. They've figured out how to get the most by doing the least.
Moving lots of water with the least amount of effort is the key to jelly's success as...
So that shows how successful they are because they don't have to use a lot of energy to move around. That's pretty crazy. And I had to cut that off because I want to make sure we have time to see this stung by a box jelly. Here's another little thing. When somebody did get stung by one of the biggest and the most venomous or deadliest of the jellies.
The Great Barrier Reef is home to a vast array of coral and fish species.
This is in the Pacific by Australia.
But here in the shallows is where we find Australia's most feared creature. It's not the shark, it's the deadly box jellyfish.
This highly venomous and nearly invisible predator is the scourge of Australian beaches, stinging scores of swimmers over the years. I'm searching for specimens with Ben Kropp. Ben, a renowned underwater filmmaker, has been researching remedies for the box jellyfish venom by getting stung over and over on purpose.
They're very hard to see, in here, really, really, really hard. In fact, almost invisible over the sand.
So these box jellyfish are technically the most dangerous creature on the planet? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, yes. Their venom is more powerful than anything.
There it is.
That's it. Yeah, he's lost some of his tentacles.
This will ruin your day at the beach.
You see how they're holding it by the medusa, by the bell, the head, because the tentacles are down here, so they're not going to get stung holding it that way.
Doesn't look like much, translucent blob of goo. But it can see, it can sense that you're there, and it has some of the most toxic venom in the world. So the plan is I'm gonna try out a new remedy for box jellyfish stings, but the only way to do it is to actually intentionally sting yourself, and that's what I'm gonna do next.
Wow.
Shall we give it a shot?
Yeah.
Okay.
So the poison then travels just under the skin, under the lymph, I think you call it,
yes.
and slowly works its way up to you. But the initial pain, people go into shock and sometimes just don't come out of it.
Great. This sounds like fun.
Oh, well.
Let's do this. Okay, I'm ready. Oh, this is gonna suck.
Go do it properly. Ready?
Yeah. Oh, man. I can feel it stinging. Oh.
We'll even leave a little bit on.
Yeah, oh, yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Oh, there you are.
Time to give the test remedy a try.
You can really feel it building up.
Yeah.
All right.
The new solution isn't working as well as I had hoped. So we move to the tried and true low-tech remedy.
Yeah, oh, there's a sensitive spot right there.
Oh, just there, okay.
Yeah, no, okay, thank you. Wow.
All right, we'll put him out of his misery. We'll give him some of this stuff here, some vinegar.
Our video said vinegar.
And you can be liberal with it, real cheap.
Yeah, look, it's all starting to raise
up.
Yeah,
you're reacting nicely.
Nicely.
It's all coming up in lumps. We might have to take you to the hospital yet.
Is there a hospital close by? Box jellyfish, one of the most dangerous creatures on the planet. Hurts like hell.
I don't think I'll try that again anytime soon.
Yeah, how would you like to do that for your job? Okay. Can you believe that? Yeah, Alonda, you're in Canada. Okay. All right, guys. Well, okay, we have some time for some questions. If I can answer any, that would be wonderful. I hope I can. I don't know everything about jellyfish, but I can try.
Okay. First is Lola. Hi, Lola. Okay, maybe Mikey first.
Okay, Mickey.
Can you open my phone, Mickey? Well, next one, let's try.
Hi. Hey, Brandon.
Yeah. Just saw you like yesterday.
Yes.
Yesterday, and I have one question, which is about the box jellyfish that you told me. How long is it, and how will it hurt? That will it sting you, and will it be very dangerous that you need to go to hospital, or you
yeah?
Just need-
I think they're they're all different sizes. And it's not like they're just gigantic, and that's not the scary part. It's their venom that's very, very strong. It's a stronger venom than other ones would just sting you and it hurts and you're like, oh, okay, ouch. Yeah. This would really almost, like they said, put you into shock. It just kind of disrupts your whole system. It could also go right to your heart and stop it. So they said that some people have an anti-venom for this, and the only way to get the anti-venom is to get the venom out of those box jellies. And that's what I believe that man was doing earlier, to get, if you get some of the venom, just like that poisonous rockfish, you get some of the venom, and that's the only, and they'll give it to hospitals so that they can have, just like snake venom, anti-venom. If you get bitten by a very bad snake, hospitals may have the anti-venom, which is the antidote, which is the antibodies from the venom that would actually help you.
Oh,
I'm not sure how big they get though. Yeah, not gigantic.
Yeah, I just watched some documentary that I have think about. Will they take the venom from the snake?
I didn't hear the end think, there.
Yeah. I think they have some problem with this foam or.
Okay.
Next one, Lisa.
Hey, Lisa.
Hi.
Hi.
I have a question about box jellyfish too.
Uh huh.
I'm wondering, like, where do they live in the ocean? Like, do they live in the shallow parts of the ocean, or do they live on really deep?
I think, Lisa, they live mostly in the shallow part. I don't think they live very deep, but I'm not 100% on that. But like you saw that man and in Australia, he was very shallow, right by the beach, getting some of them. So certain oceans have them, and I think they are mostly shallow.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much for answering.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for the question.
Okay, next one will be Tianjiaqi.
So I have a question that, can we eat jellyfish?
You know, I don't think so. I mean, I guess you could, but there's really no nutritional value that would be good for your body eating them. But I imagine you probably could, as long as you did not eat the tentacles, the stinging parts. But I think it would be just, you know, they're made of the gelatinous nothingness. You know, they're mostly water, kind of like our bodies are mostly water. Theirs almost is all water. So you wouldn't really get any benefit from, you wouldn't feel full and you wouldn't get any nutrition from it. But I guess you could eat parts of it if you wanted to.
Okay.
Not the bad part, not the stinging parts.
Okay, I got it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, next one is Yolanda.
Hi, Yolanda.
Hi. My question is, don't they go to the washroom?
Don't they go where?
To the washroom.
The bathroom? Yeah, I answered that in the chat. I saw that you put that there. Why are they do have waste products. Yeah, remember they said they eat through their mouth and they expel their waste through their mouth. They only have one opening for both. So yeah, they do. But it's small. You wouldn't, because they don't eat anything that's really big, you know. They don't have a big waste product because they don't eat much. They eat littler things, even if it's a fish. But yeah, they expel out of their mouth and they take in from their mouth. It's the same opening for both.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, that is Elsa.
Hi, Elsa.
Hi. How do jellyfish sleep?
It looks like they just kind of, then since they drift with the currents, and that's what they were saying earlier, is that they don't use a lot of energy. They don't swim and swim and swim. They just kind of drift along. So they don't need a lot of sleep, first of all, because they don't use a lot of energy. And that's what that one video was saying, is they're probably the smartest ones in the ocean because they don't have to use a lot of energy to do anything. So I guess they sleep kind of on and off as they just kind of drift around in the ocean, being alert that nothing's going to eat them, I guess, right?
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
Hello.
Hi.
Good morning.
Good morning.
it's good enough for me, sorry. So my question is, how do, like, can jellyfish kill people? Like,
yeah, that one Portuguese man of war can, and that box jellyfish, if you have enough of that stinging stuff in you, enough of that venom, it can go right to your heart. Most jellyfish, though, most of them will sting you and it hurts a while, and you put some salt water on it or vinegar like that guy had, and you're fine. But and some of those ones.
And I was stinged by two jellyfish before, but it's like electric.
Yeah, it feels like stinging, like it's on fire, doesn't it? You know, I've been stung too many times. One time I had a ton of them all over me at one time, and it hurt, but you know, it wears off and then you're fine.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Ellie.
Hello, it's my brother who has a question.
Hey, Austin.
Do any birds have poison?
Birds?
Yeah.
No, not that I know of. Nope.
Okay, thank you.
See you tomorrow, Austin.
Bye.
Bye. Austin's one of my students on Mondays.
Well, I think you answered all the questions.
Great. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I enjoyed having you guys here, and I'll be doing a webinar next week on cakes and breads and cake decorating. So make sure you attend next week because I'll be here. Thank you. Have a good rest of your evening.